My name's Jonathan, and I've worked at the Aspire Academy in Qatar for nearly 8 years. My role there is as a biomechanist. For the last 2 years, I've worked predominantly with table tennis, and prior to that, I've been working with the football teams and also the athletic squads. So I'm going to present today some multidisciplinary approaches that we use at the academy to improve the performance of our table tennis players. And I should add that I'm talking today about junior players, but then we can also use work like this for senior players as well. So I'll just give you an overview of the presentation to set the scene. So I'll talk about the Aspire Academy and the service team approach we use there to improve the performance of our players. And then I'm going to give four practical examples from my work, focusing on performance analysis, because that's the area I'm heavily involved in. Initially with strength and conditioning, this will be perhaps the longest of the four examples. And I'd like to add that I'll present some talking points after each practical example. So if you want to ask any questions then, or you want to start a discussion, I don't mind doing that then, instead of waiting till the end of the presentation. The second example, I'll talk about performance analysis and how I use that to inform the coach's assessment of a technique curriculum we've developed. Third example will be performance analysis supporting the coach's assessment of matches. And the fourth example will be performance analysis to inform psychology to improve performance of our players. And then I'll just try and summarize things at the end with a view to looking at how the service team should be adopted. Okay, so the Aspire Academy is in the capital of Qatar, Doha. This is our big blue dome. It's the world's largest indoor sports facility, and table tennis is one of our key sports there. We also have squash in-house, athletics and football, and I've worked with all these sports, but now predominantly I'm working with table tennis. And this is our shared office at the academy. We have a very nice training setup. We have areas for warm-ups, agility work. We have an area cordoned off for the very young players to work with the ball machine to do many balls work. We have screens for video replay live in training. And we also have lots of gyms there, which you can't see. So the boys will do strength and conditioning work as well. So it's a nice place to work. So how do we operate at Aspire? Well, we have this service team approach. And what that means is we have a team of personnel from different disciplines, and we work with the coach and the athletes to provide support. So we have a dietitian, we have a biomechanist and performance analyst, which is myself. I've underlined that term because also for each team, we have a coordinator. So instead of everyone bombarding the coach and athletes with information, we can funnel that through one person. So I am the main contact between the coach, players and practitioners. But of course, there is daily discussion, daily interaction. So we have psychology, we have the medical staff, a physiologist and a strength and conditioning coach. These people are there to support the coaches and the athletes. So how does this work? Well, I put this slide in. So if we imagine that the player is a high performance car, then the head coach is the guy driving it, steering the player along a performance pathway. Strength and conditioning coach, for example, would be the guy building the engine. I'm the guy coordinating the pit crew, looking after the physiologist who's monitoring how fast the car has gone. We've got the psychologist in constant interaction with the player, asking how he feels he's doing, etc., etc. So that's the sort of analogy we're working on. How can we get that car to perform better? The first thing we do really is go back to a needs analysis approach. So table tennis, what does it look like? What are the key skills we need? What do we need to do to help each player? And this will be slightly different for each player, in fact. So we need to focus on the targeted players. Not all of our players are at the same level. And we need to try and have a high impact in training and competition with this service team approach. So how does that work in reality? Well, we have a player. We may, for example, do performance analysis of how the player is winning, losing matches. That will be fed back to training from, for example, certain strokes we can work on. We will look at testing the athletes in a certain way to inform the strength and conditioning program. We'll have a physio in place that will look after the day-to-day niggles and long-term injuries. The psychologist working on keeping the player in a good mental state for training and competition. The nutrition, looking after the nutritional requirements of the player. And the physiologist for monitoring training loads, applied research, things like that. So the first example, performance analysis and strength and conditioning. For me, these two disciplines, they work very closely together. They're both movement orientated. Performance analysis can inform changes to a strength and conditioning program. This is key. We can do tests for monitoring the physical skills that are needed in table tennis, such as agility. And we can derive these tests from performance analysis data. And that leads me on to the first example. Firstly, why do we test players? We do quite a lot of testing at Aspire, but we're not testing for testing's sake. We do it for a purpose. So we're trying to track the progress of players. We're comparing between individual players. If we have a player who just comes into the academy, then we want to know where this player sits in comparison to other high-level players we've had come through the academy. The players like numbers so that they can see where they lie in relation to the training squad as well. We're not just there to service in training, we're also doing applied research to try and improve the body of scientific work in table tennis. First and foremost, for me, it's about practical use of our work. So we're trying to inform training to improve performance or reduce the potential for injury, of course. So I'll give you a short video here now of a test we developed relatively recently for our strength and conditioning coach to monitor agility. So I'll just let you watch this video and then I'll explain in a bit more detail how it was developed and why. So this is high-speed video at 300 hertz. So how did we derive this test? Well, it started from some performance analysis of the Asia Cadet Championships final that was held in Doha. I'll play you another video. You can kind of see I like my video. This is just a couple of points from the final. And they're atypical in that they were the longest 2 points in the final, but they're very nice points and they're indicative of the fast attacking style of play we see in modern table tennis. So we wanted a test that would replicate some of the sport-specific movements we will see. ATAD stands for the Aspire Table Tennis Agility Test. So how did we develop it? Well, we coded the game live using iPad and the software iCoder. So we did a temporal analysis of the match and we did a rally length analysis incorporating the number of shots and the time. We of course videoed the match and we looked at the footwork types and the footwork patterns by pre-calibrating an area using a set of SAQ ladders. So it looks something like that. It was quite a crude method but very effective actually. And it gave us more information about the movement of the players. So the results we found the following from a temporal analysis. We saw work in the literature relating to senior players, but as I said, we're dealing with a junior cohort, so we wanted to make sure we got information relating to juniors, not just taking information from senior matches that was probably done a long time ago as well. So the activation period refers to that sort of isometric half squat position when the player is waiting for the ball at the start of the rally. So the average number of shots per point was just over 4 as well. So it was important to have that information so we can relate the test to table tennis. If we'd have done a test that was 12 shots, then it's probably not typical of a rally in table tennis. We looked at the frequency of movements, and we categorized them as linear, lateral, rotational. So we could see what was happening there. The most frequent movements being the linear jump, the step, a lateral jump, and the pivot. So that's a linear step at the start of the rally, returning serve or some passive play at the net. The linear jump, which is a backwards movement to reset, ready for the next shot. The pivot turn, which was commonly seen from the backhand corner to it, a fast, aggressive forehand. And the lateral jump, an explosive movement to move sideways quickly. So we looked at the most common pattern for these movements in sequence. From that, and using also the spatial information, we developed a test. And we decided to use high-speed video for this, just for so we could have the video to observe as well. And also from a practical perspective, because we didn't want a test where we took a long time to set up and we had to take the boys for half an hour before training. So in this way, I can set up in 5 minutes and all the boys can go through the test battery just after their warm-up, and then they're straight into training. So this way the coach is happy and I'm happy as well. It doesn't need extensive analysis post. You don't need to concentrate on the words here. I just put this up. This was part of the abstract from the Sports Science Congress. And I just want to say that as well as developing a test, you can't just use it. Then we need to develop a reliable and valid test. So there's some statistical analysis and work done there to that end. I go back to the point about why we test. And one of the reasons we test is to track in training. Okay, so these are a couple of old tests, and within seconds I can just add the video from the current test to the last test that the player did, so we can start to have a look at how the player performed and why he may have been faster or slower. And then after training we can sit with the player and the coach and just give some quick feedback before we do further analysis to keep for ourselves for documentation or for maybe some applied research. One of the areas we're looking to use the information for is how we can improve. So if we take that player, actually from a battery of physical tests and the coach's ranking of the player in terms of agility, we thought he was maybe be second, but he was actually fifth in the group of 10 players. So that was interesting to have a look why he was fifth. And one of the main reasons was in his technique going for the wide forehand, whereas our fastest player, he tended to move first with his legs quickly, hit the ball, and then use that momentum to start moving in the other direction. But this player, for a wide ball, tended to move first with his hand, hit the ball, and then his technique of breaking eccentric to concentric was not so good. To give further insight to performance improvement, we do concurrent tests. We have bilateral force plates here in our table tennis gym. So we're also looking at some kinetic parameters to give us further insight as to what's happening in the development of this player. We do a variety of tests, not just the counter movement jump, which I'll show here. So we're looking at things like how much strength do we need to be able to perform this movement correctly. So within the service team, we're all different, we've all got different skills. So if it's simple statistics, I'm probably better than our strength and conditioning coach at doing some simple analysis, so we can see if the changes that have occurred are, for example, likely or very likely. One way we help each other, I'm constantly asking the physiologist for information on the best ways to statistically analyze these things. So it's about using everybody's skills and not trying to do everything yourself, but opening up the work we're doing to the different people in the team. So we take the information from the agility test, for example, and the strength and conditioning coach will modify what he's doing within the SAQ sessions to try and get further performance gains for our players. And he'll also modify what he's doing in the gym. Okay, so we can maybe say this guy needs more strength in a certain plane or whatever. Here we have one of our players doing weighted lunges. So we're not just doing generic exercises. We're trying to get the most for the time we have the players. So we're trying to do sport-specific movements in the gym to elicit the best changes. So we database all the information we have on the players in a software, smarter base, so that everybody in the service team has access to this information, and we can share that, and we can use the software, different filters to bring up reports about each individual player, so we can track that longitudinally. And that's very important for us because we're dealing with developing athletes, so we need to know how they're changing, and then we can look at why they're changing, etc. So talking points, and as I say, feel free to ask me questions or discuss some things. I thought of these talking points from this example. So if you are a coach and you have a strength and conditioning program for your squad or a player, is it related to performance? So are you doing some generic movements because everybody does these squats or these sit-ups? So how have you related what you're doing from a conditioning perspective to the actual performance, to table tennis? How are you monitoring the physical performance of the players? What tests are you using and why? And how are these results shared and used to modify training? So for me, sometimes you see people make tests and they keep the information for themselves, and it's very nice because they can see things, but you have to share this information with everyone, because you may think that somebody doesn't need to know this information, but it may spark some debate where they are trying to correlate that with something else. So it's important that that's shared. And if you can, you bring that back to how we can modify training to improve the performance of the player. Does anyone have any questions or comments on that?
What age are the athletes?
So our boys are, we have actually cadet and junior players, we have 13. So they come in, it's effectively a secondary school, the Aspire Academy. So the two players we have here are 16, and they come into the academy around 12 years of age.
So strength and conditioning would need to take account for their physiological position and the motivation program.
Yeah, definitely, yeah.
And each one could be different, so you couldn't have. How do you make sure that doing a generic test and applying it to all the students is safe if one's way behind somebody else on it?
Yeah, it's the test is the same for all the students, but our interpretation of the results is different. That's on an individualized level. So table tennis is table tennis. Some players will perform the test faster than others, but our interpretation of the results is different. So some of the players have the leg strength already to perform, let's say, good technique, others don't. And we recognize this, and the strength and conditioning programs are different for all the individual players. So the coach will take the cadet players, and then there'll be differences within that, and then the junior players will also be in the gym. And in fact, the junior players program is split into two again, but each of the players has an individualized program in the gym. That's very important.
You need to monitorize the physical performance. How you determine which is the good physical performance about us?
Yeah, well, that's we discuss on a daily basis, in fact, but we have monthly meetings with the service team to discuss the progress of all of our players. So one thing that we will do in the future as our players graduate, for example, we will have some normative data. So we can say this player achieved this level in table tennis. These were his historical results. So in the future, we will be able to do a lot more of that in terms of saying, well, this player is 13 years old. We have lots of tests on these batteries of tests. He achieved X, Y, Z. We compare that to one of our graduated players, and he achieved 1, 2, 3. So this, in the future, this will be a lot more prevalent. But at the moment, we're looking at this from a holistic service team approach and using our experience, using data, some data we have from graduated athletes and data from the literature as well. So each player has a different pathway, and we know where they start from, but we don't necessarily know where they will end. So we're looking to see performances that are above normal growth and maturation, because our boys are still developing. And yeah, that's it really.